Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Dear brothers and sisters, we are here for the Pentecost Vigil. And I am happy that I am able to be with you and reflect on the importance of Pentecost Feast with the theme, Let the Fire Fall. And that's the theme that we are going to reflect on this Pentecost Vigil. I invite each and every one of you who have gathered here, who are listening to this at this Pentecost Vigil. This is the most important moment for us, for which we have been preparing ourselves for the past 50 days. And today we are having the vigil, and tomorrow we will be celebrating the solemnity of the Pentecost, the feast of the Holy Spirit, the birth of the church, and we will be filled with the Holy Spirit, and we will have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon each one of us, and we will be a spirit-filled and spirit-led persons who are Christians. And so, I would like to invite you now to listen to this text from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. I read it to you. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Today, let us also be in the upper room, and from our heart, let this prayer arise to the heavens. Come, Holy Spirit, come and renew the face of the earth. Come with your seven gifts. Come, Spirit of life, Spirit of communion and love. The church and the world need you. Come, O Holy Spirit, and make ever more fruitful the charisms that you have bestowed on us. Give new strength and missionary zeal to these sons and daughters of yours who are gathered here and who are listening to this talk. Open their hearts, renew their Christian commitment in the world. Make them courageous messengers of the gospel, witnesses to the risen Jesus Christ, the Redeemer and Savior of mankind. Strengthen their love and their fidelity to the church. Let us also turn our gaze to our Blessed Mother Mary, who is Christ's first disciple, the spouse of the Holy Spirit, and Mother of the Church, who was with the apostles at the Pentecost, so that she will help us to learn from her fiat, docility to the voice of the Spirit. And so, let the fire fall. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, this fire that we are asking, let the fire fall, this fire is a creative force that purifies and renews. It regenerates us and makes us capable of loving. Pope Francis reminded us on August 18th, 2013. He says, Jesus wants the Holy Spirit to flare up every hearts of ours. We need the Holy Spirit to not let ourselves be held back by fear and calculation. Thanks to this fire, we are called to become people with an enthused heart and a joyful face. Very wisely, Pope Francis speaks of the desire of the fire, of the desire of light, of the desire of love that Christ came to bring. It is the fire of the Holy Spirit that will come down on Pentecost. Jesus has this great desire to light the fire. I think we can rightly say that it is the fire of the Holy Spirit that came down upon the disciples on the day of Pentecost that changed the disciples entirely and empowered them to proclaim boldly that the one whom you have killed is risen. And he is with us, and we are his witnesses. My dear brothers and sisters, just imagine, Jesus was with the apostles, with the disciples, 3 years. They have been listening to Jesus. They have been witnessing to the miracles, raising the dead to life, many healings, many miracles, the multiplication of the loaves. All these things they witnessed, and Jesus taught them. For 3 years, they had been under Christ's instruction. For 3 years, Jesus had tried his very best to make the disciples understand. And remember, Jesus was the best teacher we ever had. The apostles too had done their best. Watching Jesus, listening to Jesus, asking questions to Jesus, struggling to get the message from Jesus, and yet, time and again, we get the feeling, in spite of all their efforts, they never fully grasped what Jesus was trying to tell them. All the time Jesus was speaking to them about the importance of humility. He was telling them the greatest, the one who wants to be greatest, let him be the least. The one who wants to be master, he must be the slave. And he was teaching them about humility, to take the lowest places. And yet, what do we find among the disciples? They have been all the time arguing about who is greater among us. And many were trying to sit on the right and the left of Jesus when he comes into his kingdom as a king. That's what the disciples were all the time preoccupied with. They could never really grasp and understand the teaching of Jesus on humility. The life of Jesus, who humbled himself he became one among us as like any one of us. And so, that sometimes we hear Jesus, even in the gospel, making a big sigh. What? I have been with you so long, yet you do not know me, Philip. Those who have seen me, seen the Father. So Jesus has been telling this. And that's what we find in John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 9. And again you see in Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 14 to 21. There the disciples were disturbed. What was the reason? They had one loaf of bread with them. And so they were worried and upset that we don't have sufficient bread for us. And at that time, Jesus looks at them and tells them, "Do you still not know and understand? Are your mind so dull? You have eyes, can't you see? You have ears, can't you hear? Don't you remember the multiplication of the loaves? Don't you still not understand? That's what the disciples were. It is only on Pentecost, when the fire of the Holy Spirit fell upon the disciples, they were inspired, they were enlightened, and fully understood everything that Jesus had been trying to tell them. Now, with the utter heartfelt conviction, they step out in the open, free, independent, and speaking up for Christ's sake with incredible power and authority. It's only because they let the fire of the Holy Spirit fell upon them. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, like the apostles, we too need the Holy Spirit. The fire of the Holy Spirit should fall upon us. We need the Holy Spirit to be able to see and act as a Christian. Otherwise, it's impossible for us to be a Christian, to love as Christ loves. We see a church today who tries to renew itself, but not always successful. The Second Vatican Council came with the clarion call that the church is in need of a radical conversion. Lot of changes were brought after the Second Vatican Council. Changes in the liturgy, changes in the way the sacraments were administered, changes in the relationship with the world, changes in our attitude towards other religions. All these were introduced. But still, in spite of all the efforts, the teachings of the Second Vatican Council remained a mere dream to be realized and lived. Dear brothers and sisters, have you not felt sometimes that you really want to follow Christ? Have you not felt that? That I must follow Christ now? I must leave everything? He is the real Savior. He died for me. So I must follow Christ. Have you not felt that? Surely. But you do not have enough power. You are not able to be consistent with that. After some time you forget about it. Why? That you want to be holy. Many times you strive that I must be holy. I should not commit any sins. But try as you might, you cannot get freed from your sinful habits. You become helpless. Though you want to be holy, you're not able to get rid of your bad habits. And as a result, you are stuck. That you really want to love your neighbors. But all the time, there is just that one person you cannot forgive. How can you love the neighbors? That you want to pray. Pray fervently. Henceforth, my life will become a life of prayer. You make that decision. That you want to be perfect. That you want to be fully united with God. But all by yourselves, you feel so dry, so empty, so dull, that you find it impossible to raise your hearts to the Lord. If that is so, perhaps I and you need the Holy Spirit. It's time for us to pray to the Holy Spirit. It's the right time. We are in the Pentecost vigil. Tomorrow we will be celebrating the Feast of Pentecost, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, not a past event, but a real event here and now. The Spirit, the fire of the Holy Spirit will fall upon us and will possess us, envelop us, take control of us, anoint us with the fresh anointing. So we need to turn to the Holy Spirit now and pray to the Holy Spirit. That is very much needed. I, from my own life, I can tell you, as a young priest, I have been faithful in all my duties, administering the sacraments, offering the Holy Eucharist worthily, and looking up to the pastoral needs, the evangelization work. But all that I did it as a kind of a duty, as a kind of a responsibility as a priest. But it's only when I began to experience the power of the Spirit within me through the baptism in the Holy Spirit, everything changed. Everything became so meaningful. Jesus became so alive. He became a real person to me. It's only the Delhi service team, charismatic service team, they started initially calling me for their recollections to give them a talk and help them out. I was going faithfully and doing it. It's only later when Cyril John, Brother Cyril John, has been calling me and making me to participate in some of the programs, the Catholic charismatic programs, and it is there I began to experience the power of the Spirit that changed my life. And for me, everything became new. We need the Holy Spirit. Dear brothers and sisters, that we need the Holy Spirit. Without Him, we will never understand what Jesus tries to tell us. Without Him, we cannot pray. Without Him, there will be no real love in our hearts. Without Him, there will be no insights. Without Him, there will be no warmth. Without Him, no genuine conviction. We will go through our prayers like a parrot without Him. We will not be able to fulfill even the smallest duty in our Christian life without the Holy Spirit. Without Him, there will be no saints, there will be no martyrs. The big renewal which the Second Vatican Council had in mind, without the Holy Spirit, it will never materialize. That's why we need the fire of the Holy Spirit to fall on us. That's why Jesus says, how will the Heavenly Father refuse the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? Luke chapter 11 verse 13. So let the fire of the Holy Spirit fall. We read in Luke's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 49, where Jesus says, I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. Jesus wishes this fire to be aflame. That is His desire. When Moses and Aaron in the Old Testament, we read, especially in Leviticus, Moses and Aaron were building the tabernacle. After the construction of the tabernacle, they are having the sacrifice. And there, the fire was lit by God, not by Aaron the priest. The fire was lit by God. We read in Leviticus chapter 9, verse 24, fire came out from the Lord and consumed the burnt offering and the fat on the altar. And when all the people saw it, they shouted and fell on their faces. Again, we read in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 9. The Lord said to Moses, command Aaron and his sons, the fire on the altar shall be kept burning. Again, in Leviticus chapter 9, verse 12, the fire on the altar shall be kept burning. It shall not go out. Repeatedly, it is said again in the next verse, a perpetual fire shall be kept burning on the altar. It shall not go out. That is the fire of God. That is the fire of the Holy Spirit. And so every priest kept the fire burning, which is lit by God. In the New Testament, on the day of Pentecost, the fire came upon every disciple. This fire lit by God, and it has to be continued. And this fire should be kept burning. Tomorrow we will be celebrating the feast of the Pentecost to keep this fire alive. within us. Because this fire is the fire of the Holy Spirit lit by God. Now we have four secrets I would like to share with you on this Pentecost vigil. How that fire has been kept burning in the Acts of the Apostles. The first secret, it is a spirit-filled church. A fire-filled church. A fire-filled church or a spirit-filled church means where the presence of Jesus, where the experience of Jesus becomes a reality. In the church where the presence of Jesus, where the experience of Jesus becomes a reality. That church is a spirit-filled church. That church is a fire-filled church. In the Acts of the Apostles, we read that all the apostles experienced the presence of the living, risen Jesus Christ. None of them ever doubted the presence of the risen Lord after the fire of the Spirit fell upon them. Acts chapter 1, verse 2 to 3, we read, until the day he was taken up, to them he presented himself alive by many proofs appearing to them. They said, he is risen, he is alive, he is with us, he keeps us alive. Taught them about the kingdom. That's why Peter in his first preaching says, I seek the Lord all the time. I seek the Lord all the time. He is all the time before me. They had a deep awareness of Jesus with them. Do we have that awareness? Do we experience the presence of Jesus in us every moment? Do we all the time keep the Lord before us? And for that, we need the Holy Spirit. That's why Acts chapter 3 verse 6, Peter says to the crippled beggar at the beautiful gate, he says, I have no silver or gold, but what I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus, stand up and walk. Peter says, I have nothing of silver, gold or this world's wealth. No power, but I have Jesus within me. Are we Christians able to say that? Are we priests, religious, able to say that? I have Jesus with me. I am an anointed person. I am a consecrated person. I belong to Jesus. I have received the Holy Spirit. Am I able to say, I have Jesus with me. I can give you Jesus. As Peter and John said, Acts chapter 7, verse 60, the presence of Jesus was so real that the deacon Stephen, when he was being stoned to death, he was not able to see the stones. He was not able to see the executioners, but he was seeing Jesus. Here is a person who is filled with the Spirit. Here is a person who is all the time filled with the presence of Jesus. And that's why he is seeing Jesus even at that horrible and cruel moment where he is being killed. Acts chapter 12 verse 6 we read, Peter so filled with the Spirit of Jesus that he in between, can you imagine, he in between two soldiers sleeps so peacefully in the prison. No problem, because he was filled with Jesus. Jesus is with him. The challenge before us is, are we able to experience the presence of Jesus in our midst? You look at St. Paul's experience on the way to Damascus, changed him thoroughly. The Spirit took control of him, possessed him. The one who was persecuting the Christians, the Spirit could transform him into the preacher of the kingdom. The preacher of the gospel established so many churches. In his letter to the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 1 to 9, he says, now I would remind you, my brethren, Christ died for our sins, and he rose, appeared to Cephas, last of all, he appeared to me. This is the essential requirement for anyone to do the mission. They had the first hand experience, not told by someone, a church or a ministry that fails to present the presence of Jesus is miserable. The second one, the Acts of the Apostles church, which we can also call a high voltage church. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 5 verse 1 to 11, we read the account of Ananias and Sapphira. It is an act of hypocritical mind, insincere, unauthentic. They deceived the apostles. They put the Holy Spirit to the test. Because of this insincerity and lie, they fell dead. And verse 11 we read, seeing Ananias and Sapphira, because of their ingenuity, because of their life, falling dead in front of the apostles, a great fear came upon the whole church. The world witnessed a mighty God who is with the apostles. So, are we really true Christians? Are we not like Ananias and Sapphira? Fake Christians, fake priests, fake religious, not living up to the call, up to our commitment? The book of Joshua chapter 2 verse 9 to 10, the prostitute Rahab, she says, "We heard the Lord how he dried up the Red Sea, a mighty people and a mighty God." Acts 4, 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. Third, the church which is natural and supernatural. When we read the Acts of the Apostles, we see in the church a beautiful blend of natural and supernatural. On the day of Pentecost, with the mighty wind and heavenly fire, they were drastically changed. The miraculous conversion of Paul, the extraordinary events that is around the apostles, at the same time, ordinary events were there, quarrels and partiality among the widows serving. The apostles were beaten up, there was persecution, so the ordinary events were there. The church in the Acts of the Apostles had episodes surpassing the ordinary. Today, sometimes we are so much worried and frightened about the present adverse situation the church is facing in the country. But we need to remind ourselves that the church survived the most atrocious, cruel emperors of history. In Rome, the Christians were persecuted so cruelly, but today Rome is the center of Christianity. This is because the supernatural power of the church. Examine for what people approach us. The disciples of John the Baptist came to Jesus and asked, "What shall we tell John?" And Jesus told them, "Go and tell John all that you see." Acts chapter 20 verse 18 to 24, Paul tells Ephesians about his mission. "I am going to Jerusalem bound by the Holy Spirit and don't know what happens to me there. But I do not count my life of any value to myself." Fourthly, a church which is a church listening to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. We have to continuously listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. They always prayed and took decisions. Dear brothers and sisters, Pentecost surely is not the story of the past. The Holy Spirit is always with us. We must let the fire of the Holy Spirit to fall on us as in the upper room. He is still waiting for his chance to stir our hearts with a new fire and better intentions and deeper understandings. Should I try to be a better priest, a better religious? Should I try to be a better husband, a better wife? This is the Holy Spirit stirring us with His fire to renew us. This is inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Let me make a fresh start. Let me make a good confession. Let me do my utmost to be pure. Let me give some more charity. Let me give some more time, more attention to others. Let me speak the truth. Let me take my prayer life seriously. Let me read a bit more about my faith. Let me bring change in my life. This is the Holy Spirit speaking in our hearts, urging and pushing us, come on, try to get a little more closer to your Lord. Are we really open for Him? And do we give Him enough chance? If so, He will certainly come to us as well. And He will give our faith that same fire and that same powerful depth which made the first disciples so strong and so convincing. And so, my dear brothers and sisters, at this Pentecost vigil, let us prepare as we celebrate the feast of Pentecost tomorrow during the Mass. We all should be filled with the Spirit. The fire of the Holy Spirit should fall on us and make us to be Spirit-filled and Spirit-led Christians. Amen.